Okay, so Var told you all about the new features that are coming to they're coming to Transmart, but just like the schema of Transmart, this project has many dimensions. One of them is the more developer oriented. So what I will tell you about is what kind of impact this project will have on future developments and also developers themselves. So there are the few points that we'll touch upon, and all the changes that 17.1 project will introduce. Well, briefly, we'll clean up the repositories. We'll introduce one-step build together with a completely new build system, and also a bit of a revamp of automated testing. We'll update the dependencies, so version of the Java, Groovy, and Rails, several others. The whole RESTful API will be revamped. And we'll of course consolidate the database schema, the star schema from I2B2. Well, actually, Vart already told you quite some things about it, so I will be brief. And last but not least, about the documentation used for by developers doing development. So the RESTful API and the database. At the end of presentation, if I fit in the time, I'll also tell you something about Arvados Keep, and why is it such a good thing that we'll have it integrated in 17.1. So let's get started. So the cleanup of repositories. You might ask, all right, why do we need to start with any cleanup of repositories? So let me tell you a story. Let's say you have development version of Transmart here at the bottom. And this friendly cat up there, his name is Tomcat. You might not know it, but he runs your Transmart, or in most cases, probably. And in order to get Transmart to Tomcat, you need one file. It's called var file, and it contains all the Java codes, the Groovy codes, assets, everything that you need to run it. And before you get there, you need to build this file out of several repositories. So before you get there, you need all of those. Most of them you're probably familiar with. Core API, CoreDB, RESTful API. All of that sounds good and necessary. But there are also several other dependencies that you probably have not even heard of, but which are absolutely crucial for successful build of Transmart. And those are the and so like legacy DB. Those are repositories which contain older code, which is still crucial for Transmart app to be built. And all of that wouldn't be that bad if not for the fact that every single one of those bricks has its own separate Git repository. So in total, there are 10 of such repositories which are core. That means that you cannot really build a working version of Transmart without any of them. Take away one, and you will not build it. You might ask, okay, but if I want to modify just one of them, and I create pull request, your developer creates a pull request to that, and it feels neat because you don't need to touch repository of, let's say, RESTful API if you modify Transmart app. But all those components are very tightly coupled. They don't. If we diverge on version of some of those components, you might run into a lot of problems with building that. This is why we decided to consolidate the core repositories of Transmart required for build, and also plus Transmart data, into one. This has several nice consequences, in fact, for the build process and for the testing. So first, let me get started with one-step build. One-step build is one of those things that programmers talk about, that this is a sign of having good programming practices. What does it mean? Does Transmart have one-step build already or not? Well, in fact, if you want to run Transmart just for yourself, not a development version, probably you can just fetch a var file from Bamboo and just run it, but this is not exactly a one-step build. In order to get from development version of Transmart to a running one, you need to have a database with correct schemas. You need to have correct versions of all the dependencies, and also quite a few. Well, and then you just need to start it with your build system and hope that all the versions of all the branches from all the 10 repositories actually align into perfect constellation. And yeah, and about that, the versioning. So each of those repositories gives you one artifact. So this is usually a jar file, which consists of assets, compiled Java classes, and so forth. And the thing is that when developers modify them, they usually don't bump new version. Otherwise, we would be on a very high one. Maybe that's a different discussion. Maybe we should. But the practice in Transmart is that each of those artifacts is versioned with a major version, like 16.2, and then snapshot. That means if I modify RESTful API, I don't see the change to be major, I might introduce a breaking change, which will make it incompatible with CoreDB and Core API, but from version you will not know it, so that you have to align them perfectly in having, being from the more or less the same time. This is another nice consequence of having a single repository. This worry just goes out of the window. Yeah, actually, before I get to the next point, imagine that you have to make this pull request to RESTful API. Let's say, quite recently, for Glowing Bear UI, we had to add patient count for a given concept. This is a very small change, just one more field in JSON is being returned. And you would think, how many pull requests do we need to make to introduce this change? Well, of course, RESTful API, because that's where it gets. Well, then we have to also modify CoreDB just a little bit, because that's where the data comes from. But CoreDB just implements interfaces from Core API. Okay, so we have three pull requests. And well, in this particular case, because we touch ontology term that's also used in security model, here you go. You have to modify also Transmart app. And why is this a bad thing? Well, this is because of testing. Every time you create a pull request, automated tests have to run. And if your setup does not correctly fetch matching branch of your code, let's say I modified RESTful API, but the test setup will fetch a different branch for CoreDB, let's say, it will fail. And those two kind of things make development of Transmart harder, unnecessarily so. And this is one thing that, another thing that goes away with a single repository. Okay, but what about the build itself? In Grails 2, which is a framework in which Transmart until now was developed, all the build was done with custom Gantt scripts. And those were Groovy scripts, or more precisely, domain-specific language extension of Groovy, which was handling the building of artifacts. It was not really used outside of Grails 2, and Grails 2 itself deprecated it with next version. Since we upgraded to new version of Grails 3, we got Gradle, which happens to be a completely different beast, and also a very successful open source project. With the introduction of Gradle came quite a few opportunities, and one of them is an introduction of one-step build. Our ambition here is to implement setting up database, setting up all the dependencies that are necessary for running development version of Transmart just in one step. Like you see at the bottom, that's in ideal scenario what you would need just to set up Transmart. And it can be done. Yeah, so one thing that I already touched upon is the test setup. Together with simplified repository structure, test setup becomes also much cleaner. Let's imagine that you fork Transmart. Well, in open source community, you would like to people to fork Transmart and make their own extensions. And let's say you fork it now, and you might you want to make a contribution. The problem is that Travis setup, which is being used for running the tests, is not likely to run correctly, because your development branch is unlikely to match those that Travis will fetch for Transmart Foundation repository. In single repository structure, this problem goes out of the window. Second issue that's being addressed here in 17.1 is that of testing using test database. Until now, we used H2 in-memory database, which was good enough for isolated tests, but still not quite as close to production. One small step toward more reliable tests here is that we'll use Oracle and Postgres in test setup as well. All right, so I mentioned Gradle, but what's that? So I guess everyone will agree that using good solutions out there, that smart people who encountered problems you already had solved as well, it's a good idea. And that's basically what's using Gradle from Transmart is. Gradle is a vastly popular build system that really caught a lot of wind in the wings when it was adopted by Android. It solves two issues: multi-language, multi-project builds. That was the issue that Android had. A lot of small projects that have to be combined into a bigger one, sometimes mixing different languages. And that happens to be also Transmart, because Transmart is mainly two languages on the backend, Groovy and Java, and also, maybe much more importantly, consists of 17 components, some of them optional, some of them mandatory, and many other transition dependencies. Gradle is just a good fit for that. Right, so now we covered all the cleanup repositories and how it cascades into build process, how it simplifies testing. And I'll tell you something about one long overdue job, which is update of Java version. We're talking about releasing software that's supposed to ship in 2017. But until so far, the Java version on which Transmart was running was deprecated since April 2015. That might not be that big of a deal so far, but if you consider that security updates will no longer come. So let's say, should someone discover a security vulnerability in Java 7, well, we'll be out in the cold because Oracle will not provide any patch, any support. So this is one small thing that in 17.1 is addressed. We'll move to Java 8. It also has several other consequences that I'll tell you about. Grails 2 does not support Java 7. So we had to move to Grails 3, which is a new version. And Grails 3 runs on Groovy 2.4, not on Groovy 2.1. And this kind of dependencies cascade into more dependencies that needs to be updated. Also the database layer, Hibernate, and several others. But let me just pinpoint a few major advantages of the update. Well, aside from the security aspect that we are running on a modern version of Java, we might get, well, actually two tangible things. So Transmart is written in Groovy, mostly. And Groovy is language which makes heavy use of functional programming. And functional programming in Java 7 was not existent. So Groovy 2.1 was basically a hack on top of Java 7, which not in a very efficient or elegant way allowed closures, lambdas, and so forth. With Java 8, all the functional programming, well, becomes mainstream and mainly supported. That gives us hope that performance might slightly increase. And the second improvement is, that with new version of Hibernate, which is our persistence layer on top of Postgres or Oracle abstraction layer, we will be able to throw away some of the hacks and workarounds we had to implement for Transmarts to work. Okay, so now we got out of the way with all the very technical stuff on the back end, updating dependencies, versions of language frameworks and so forth, unifying the repositories, improving test system and the build. But there are also more tangible things that I would like to cover. It's about the RESTful API. So actually, Vart already mentioned that we want to version RESTful API. And motivation for that is clear. RESTful API is being used in production. It's being used by the new UI, Glowing Bear. It's used by our interface, by several other third-party applications, Spotfire integration, and so forth. They need to stay working, but the development also has to continue. So in order to accommodate that, we need to version RESTful API. Well, Vart already told you about it, so I'll be quick. There are two approaches we could take. We could either encode version in the header of HTTP request or inside URL. We went for encoding inside URL. So like you see, common REST call slash studies, which gets you all the studies that are given. Transmart becomes slash v1 studies. This is just more testing friendly, because let's say if you are to test in command line RESTful API, you are unlikely to add headers to your requests. Well, that's just a small thing, but this kind of things may increase the barrier of entry for testing RESTful API. And that's why we leaned more towards this solution. Second thing of that will be improved when it comes to RESTful API is the documentation. What you see here is the GitHub page for RESTful API. And to be honest, that's actually already quite good. You have everything you need, all the calls, description of what gets in and gets out. But there are some elementary sort of things that can be still improved. So this is a static document. Whenever I make changes to RESTful API, I have to go there and I have to remember that I have to modify it. And I cannot make a mistake, because the only thing that will validate me are other developers. They say, hey, you made a typo in there, and probably someone is now swearing at their screen because they didn't realize it was patient sets, not patient sets. This sort of things. But we are living 21st century and there are solutions. And it's one of them, OpenAPI. From going from static documentation page, we want to go into a more dynamic living document generated from a specification. Formerly, this tool was known as Swagger. Swagger, or OpenAPI nowadays, is in essence just a specification with language to describe what is your RESTful API, what it accepts as input and what it returns, what are the routes, what are the HTTP methods, and so forth. It also comes with a suite of tools, and this is one of the examples. These tools allow you to play with example responses so that you can learn how the REST API work. And, well, one more advantage of that is that this document is generated from a specification. So once I modify RESTful API, I just have to modify a YAML file with the specification. I don't have to go into a README file, modify Markdown, worry about styling, and that I don't make typos. That's increases reliability and makes it just more accessible. Okay, now I'm going, actually I'll skip over this part, maybe we'll go through it very quickly, because I wanted to also tell you a bit about Arvada's Keep, and the time is running out quickly. Because this part was covered mostly by Vart, but only one thing that I wanted to complement to a very good explanation given to you previously, by Vart on the changes to the schema is, what we are dealing with. That's a star schema, and all the changes that we implement happen in the context of just those few tables that orbitate around so-called observation fact table. And source schema is not something really Transmart or I2v2 specific. That's a more broader way of organizing data in SQL stores. And it works in essence like this, that we have a central table like this, in this case, observational fact, and it contains some tables with foreign keys to so-called dimensions. And those dimensions complement this information with some additional data. Like I have observation, that can be any kind of abstract information, and it might have associated patient, sample, and so forth. So for instance, what we see here, except for the study and trial visit blocks, is the old situation from 16.2 with several dimensions from I2, B2, out of which few are used in Transmart. The only two that are used as a primary key in 16.2 is concept. It's a concept and patience, of course. So this was also the reason why you couldn't really have multiple samples per concept concept patient pair, longitudinal data, and so forth. Because even though we already had star date as dimension, it was not really used as a part of primary key. But let me skip over that. Yeah, so Vart already mentioned that one of the deliverables of the project will be documentation. But just one more thing that I wanted to add to it is that we will ship documentation as part of the repository, to be inside the GitHub repository. This just let us, by experience we had with Transmart Batch. Transmart Batch had its documentation entirely inside code repository. This has two big advantages. First of all, people mostly get the source code and therefore the program itself from the repository. So this is the place where they will look for documentation, for links to it or documentation itself. So they will always find it. And second of all, documentation, like everything else, needs to be version controlled. And you would like to have the version matching what you use. Again, if you have it inside the repository, the version will match. And this is the whole point I would like to make here. And let me, in the last few minutes I have, just cover some things about Arvados. So it's unfortunate that we couldn't hear more about Arvados as a platform. It's, I would like to just advertise advantages of Arvados Keep, which is a file storage, which will be integrated as part of 17.1 project. Well, I believe it's actually a really good solution for storing, especially genomic data. And I'll tell you why in a few words. Well, what you see here is a simple diagram which shows what happens when you submit data to Arvados Keep. Well, Arvados Keep in essence is just a general purpose storage system, but it has several nice features. And Vart already mentioned one of them. This is data deed application. And this data deed application you might have already experienced in several other cloud-based solutions, like for instance Dropbox. You may notice that sometimes when you drop a file, especially a big one, into Dropbox, sometimes it takes really long, sometimes slow, and of course you may attribute that to slower, faster connection, but what really might be at play at given time, especially when the time is very short, is that you simply uploaded a file which contained elements which were already there, that you uploaded before. And this is what Dropbox and Keep has its code in common, that every piece of data that comes into it is chunked into small pieces of fixed size, 64 megabytes, that's configurable, but as a default. Then a hash is being taken, which allows to identify what's kind of like a unique identifier of a given chunk. And then it does a lookup do I already have this chunk, be it in collection of given user or everywhere else? If I already have this particular chunk of file, then I will not upload it. I will just introduce a reference link. That has really a huge impact on storing NGS data, because as we know, this is highly repetitive. Well, thank you. This is all I wanted to tell you today. And well, maybe just a small conclusion, that 17.1 is not just a project full of features for users, but also a project which will do a major cleanup for developers and help keep projects more predictable and cheaper. Thank you.
So you are talking about different dimension tables that you are going to reactivate in 17.1 and add additional dimension table that was not part of I2B2. So there will be a visit dimension, and then there will be a clinical visit dimension, a trial visit that will have to be on a scale. So it always have to be on a scale. Like, so you have to have it mapped to week one, week two, or it can be without the mapping. No, but if you have a visit, you have visits, but then you have screening visit and you have unscheduled visits.
Thanks.
Do you have to assign them a specific time point?
So you have these two types of visits. You have, on the one hand, patient-specific time-stamped visits. And in that case, you wouldn't use the I2B2 type of visit, grouping multiple observations for one patient. If you have in your study multiple observations which are shared over patients, then you would use the trial visit.
Okay, but in a timestamp visit, sometimes you get data, and then you have visit day.
Okay, so not
then it can be kind of a timestamp because you have a visit day.
Yeah.
But sometimes you get data and all you have there is it's visit one, visit two, visit three, screening, unscheduled visit. Then you cannot always map them to a specific time, like unscheduled visits.
No, but these trial visits don't necessarily need to have a specific time. So you can just use them as baseline week one, week two screening, or whatever. And some of them you can give a value and a unit, which the value and the unit are not obligatory.
Oh, okay, so it's not, okay. And then can you cross map this visit? So you have I2B2 visit and that has dates.
Yes.
And then you have trial visit and those have a trial day.
They can have
this. Can you cross map them and say this is trial day one was on this visit date?
No, so the linking goes via the observation. So you can.
Can you map the same observation to two visit table?
You can link. Yeah. You can link the observation both to a visit, which is patient-specific visit, and to this trial visit.
Okay. Thank you. And my second question was about RNA-seq. You have mentioned that you can load RNA-seq now as transcripts.
Not yet, but yes,
that will come. You will be able to load it. Transcripts have coordinates, yeah. And then you can map them to a gene. Mm-hmm. Then for that you would probably need to keep a gene assembly information for the original data when it was generated, because transcript could have had different coordinates.
Yeah.
So there will be a gene assembly somewhere stored for the data.
So what you always do uploading high dimensional data, you have this platform, right?
Mm, yeah.
And this platform has these coordinates, and in the parameters for the platform itself, you can at least set a genome build. I think you can also set a assembly.
The genome build is assembly, same thing.
Yeah, okay. I mean, sometimes you have transcript queries inside, mm-hmm. but okay. At least you can set the genome build on the platform level.
Okay, and then it will be somewhere visible when you're looking at the data, like 5 years from now, you come and look at it. And
if you normally right click on a high dimensional node, you will see the platform information there in the pop up.
Okay. And the last question. So you're bringing all sorts of fields in the observation fact back, like start date, end date for an observation. How about concept CD? If somebody wants to use the ICD-10 codes, maybe they can just use the codes and have the concept CD dimensional table for that.
Yes, I think the concept CD is already used, linking to the concept table. So there is already a code there. I'm not sure whether there
is. But the concept CD now and the concept is the same thing.
I think so.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Yeah.
Yeah, you have just one detail there, because when you have one study in which you loaded the concepts for this study, so every concept will be attached to one path. And then this path will receive one concept CD. So in a second moment, if you reload the data about that study, the concept path is going to be the same, but the concept CD will be updated. So then you have this trouble on Transmat.
Yeah, that's your specific way, I guess.
No, this is on the 16, I'm talking about 1.2 version.
Yeah, so I guess...
They update all the concepts when you reload data for the same study.
Yeah.
Even though the structure of the tree is the same, even though the path is the same, but the concept will be different.
Yeah, so in the 17.1, we go back to the I2B2 thing where you define the concept tree basically separate from when you upload your data. So I think that problem shouldn't really occur then, right? Yeah.
Okay, then again, so there is also in the concepts map, in the observation fact map, there is this blob field where you can put everything else that does not fit anywhere else. So can you, are you going to have the blob in the 16.1?
I don't know the blob. Does anyone know the blob?
In blob you can just put whatever stuff about that concept that does not fit anywhere else. And you cannot really, you know, search for it or subset for it, but you can pull it out with a concept when you're just pulling out all the information.
Yeah, I don't think we have any plans for the blob field itself. I think you do have modifiers if you want to put extra information on observations, and maybe that would be an alternative place.
Okay, how about update date? So right now we've been loading data incrementally, and sometimes we would load a new version and override the values for the variables. Yep. So it would be nice to have an update date for each concept.
It would be nice.
It's in the observation fact, so it's going to be...
There is an update date there. Okay.
There is update date.
I don't think we have any specific plans for that. Still need to leave some work for later.
Any other questions? Oh, there's one over here.
I'll
take it over.
The worm's like heavy steel.
So, but as you know, we are very keen to have this new functionality, so we are looking forward to it, particularly the longitudinal data and the sample data. Mm-hmm. But you were mentioning that it's only in the database and it doesn't work with the user interface. So yeah. I didn't get that part entirely. So what do we need to do to really get it to the end users? Huh?
Yeah, that's a great point. So the 17.1 project, development project, is a backend project, as we mentioned before. And I gave some reasons, and mainly because it's a lot of work. One of the things, of course, we have running our multiple UI projects, and Vibo, of course, shown the Glowing Bear UI. Our plan is definitely to accommodate the new features that we built in the 17.1 backend in the Glowing Bear UI. But funding is running out in translocation project, so we cannot make any promises on what's going to be delivered there. We'll definitely try to make at least a beta release or something when 17.1 comes out. I think, Keith, but you can speak to this better, I think for the 17.1 version, the idea is to have more UI kind of focused release. So I think it might need to wait a little bit before you can see those in the UI.
It's a great topic for our discussion later.
I think so, yeah.
What's this? Yeah, we need to mop up the funding to do that. Yeah. I mean, now trying to, you know, get everywhere bits and pieces from some IMI projects. Ideally, we should do a similar project on the UI. Or, going backwards, we had eventually, we had a goal for this project.
Yeah, it's all about scope and what you can cover. I think the scope for the 17.1 project, we would have loved to include a lot of UI work, but we just didn't have the scope for that or the support for that, and I think that's really the challenge. As we talk about the roadmap for the future, I think certainly UI there is a very important aspect, but what it was felt, I think, by other sponsors, the foundation, is that you can't do that kind of work until you have the data. So getting the data representation right creates an opportunity for those new UIs.
And I think I want to say API users are users too. There is a lot of bioinformaticians and people who
make
want.
Sure that they get logged as users?
Yeah, they're being logged actually as registered.
Just to clarify, can you tell me in the revised schema where sample ID fits in? Because you gave the example of different tissues, and I'm concerned about, you know, biobanking linking to biobanking data, and that's usually indexed by a sample ID. And so is that a part of the observation fact table, or?
Yes, yeah, so good point. We're not really going to the fact where you have samples and samples have samples again, et cetera. You can have for a patient multiple observations for the same patient concept pair, and you can make them unique with modifiers, for example, or with this instance num thing. You could attach a modifier there, a sample ID, and then store that. So maybe that should be a convention to do it like that. But so there's no dedicated sample identifier, and these 10 samples link to this patient identifier.
Yeah, well, for when is that an important consideration?
Yeah, but I think you can model it and not in a too hacky way if you just use modifiers with sample IDs pointing to these multiple observations coming from different samples.
Rudy?
Hi.
Maybe take one more quickly, but we need to get, it's going to be, we need to get back on schedule a little bit, so we'll have the short break and get started at 3:30. Want to take one more question, that's fine.
Okay. Here we go.
So you said the API is the main of the core, the database and the core API are in scope for the 17.1 project. The UI or the interface is not part of that, but now I'm wondering, the loading, is that in scope? So are we able to to put data in? So are the loading processes, for example, Transmart Batch, prepared for loading data that fits into the database? And the other end is the export. So are you able to export the data in the right format, so including the longitudinal data in a format that is can be understood by programs that you make use of to export the data?
Yeah, good questions. Should have put it in there. Again, I need to iterate here. Indeed, we didn't have all the money we had, so we need to limit ourselves. ETL is basically not part of the project. It's not guaranteed under there. But of course you need an ETL to test these features. And that's as far as we're committed to build an ETL. At least we need to get the data in there to be testable. So we'll definitely build some ETL into Transmart Batch. It might not be the most user-friendly and the nicely documented and awesome ETL that you hope for, but there will probably be some ETL, but I can't make hard promises there.
Okay, and the export, so the REST API, of course, but yeah, can you export the full study and indeed get all the data?
Via the REST API, you can get all the data as long as you have access to it.